I'm here to talk to you about entropy. Entropy can order stuff, and entropy cares about shape. And entropy cares about shape in such a way that it's become surprising to scientists, and we're just beginning to appreciate what the ramifications are. Designing new building blocks of matter with concepts of entropy and shape in mind is giving rise to a new generation of very exciting ideas and new materials with really cool properties. But let's start at the beginning. We all have learned back in kindergarten that matter uses all kinds of forces to hold stuff together. So we've learned in basic chemistry and physics classes about covalent bonds and ionic bonds and hydrogen bonds that hold water molecules together. And many of you have maybe heard about van der Waals forces that are responsible for helping geckos to stick onto walls and ceilings and not fall off when they walk. And these kinds of forces are what holds stuff together. And we've all seen the periodic table, and we know that these elements, either in combination or on their own, can form all sorts of interesting crystal structures because of the forces that we just talked about. For example, sodium and chlorine can combine together into the familiar rock salt structure, and there's even more complicated kinds of crystal structures. One of the most complicated for a single element to form on its own is one from that manganese forms, which has 20 atoms in a repeat unit. Another concept that is critically important to how stuff is held together is the concept of entropy. And entropy is something that's not a force like these other forces, but it can be thought loosely as a statistical force. So what is entropy? Entropy is the reason why we don't all fall asleep right now due to oxygen deprivation. And why is this? Entropy is the reason why all of the oxygen atoms all of the oxygen molecules in the room prefer to be scattered randomly throughout the room and are not instead piled up onto my hand to form a big block letter M. And the reason for this is that there are so many more ways for oxygen molecules to randomly be disordered throughout the room than to organize in one small space or in any kind of a pattern, say in an M in my hand. And the fact that entropy is related to the number of ways of organizing stuff was recognized by Mr. Boltzmann, who lived in the latter part of the 19th century. And this is a picture of his tombstone in Vienna, which at the top, it may be hard to see, but circled in yellow is this expression that I wrote up at the top that says that entropy, which he called the letter S, is equal to a constant times the logarithm of the number of ways of arranging stuff. And this expression to a statistical physicist or a thermodynamicist is as revered as Newton's F equals ma or Einstein's E equals mc squared. And it's exactly this example of oxygen molecules preferring to be randomly distributed throughout this room that contributes to our everyday or colloquial notion that entropy is synonymous with disorder. But that's only sometimes correct. And if you get one thing out of this talk today, it's that instead of thinking of entropy as being disorder, we should be thinking of entropy as being synonymous with options. Entropy is about ways of arranging stuff, and that's important because entropy can order stuff if there are more ways of being ordered than being disordered. And that may sound counterintuitive to many of you, but let me give you some examples. So here are two computer simulations that I'm going to show you. There are two boxes of hard particles in them. The one on the right has prolate ellipsoids that are like long rice grains, and the one on the left are oblate ellipsoids like, I don't know, spree candies. And think of them as being hard particles, almost like billiard balls if they were suspended in some kind of solution and could jiggle around. There are no other interactions, no attractive forces, no covalent bonds, ionic bonds, none of that stuff. Just banging together due to thermal collisions. And now we'll run these computer simulations, and we start off initially with all of the particles randomly arranged, and the color red denotes that the particles have a random orientation or position relative to their neighbors. And as I start this simulation, you'll see by the color green, which we use to denote particles that are ordered locally relative to their neighbors, that they start to align, they start to order with each other. And if we run it long enough, we see that this order starts to pervade the whole box. And this is because there are more ways for these particles to be aligned and ordered with each other than for them to stay disordered. Now, this may not seem so counterintuitive. After all, we know that if we had a bunch of pencils on a table and we started to corral them together and they started to pack more and more densely, then pretty soon the pencils would run into one another and they'd have to line up if we wanted to get them even denser. But what is counterintuitive to many people is that entropy can even order spheres. So here on the left is a computer simulation, just like the one that I showed, or the two I showed a minute ago, only the particles are spherical now instead. They start off initially completely randomly, and now we run the simulation, and the particles are jiggling with thermal motion, and they're banging against each other, and pretty soon they start to order, and that's denoted by these green regions, into crystals. So this box of particles is crystallizing right before our eyes. And what's happening is that there are more ways for the particles to be ordered than there are to be ordered. And so entropy is driving the crystallization of these spheres. Now, this particular crystal structure is known to material scientists and chemists as a face-centered cubic crystal structure, and that's what its atomic structure looks like. And if you go back to the periodic table of the elements, you see that there are many examples of structures that are the same face-centered cubic structure, and you can mix elements together and also get the face-centered cubic structure. What's really interesting is that this way of arranging spheres has been known back in early writings of Sanskrit writings, back to 499 CE. They wrote about what's the best way to organize spheres if you wanted to pack them as densely as possible. And Johannes Kepler conjectured in the 1600s that the densest you could possibly pack spheres together is pi over the square root of 18. But it took a mathematician by the name of Hales till 1998. He proved that Kepler was correct, but it took the mathematician 7 years to check the proof. So it wasn't published until 2005. And so the densest that you could, if you have hard spheres all of identical sizes and you try to put them together in a box, you can't get them any denser than 74.05%. And why is that interesting? Well, because shape matters. And any of us who's ever gone on a trip and has to pack a suitcase with stuff knows that the shape of the stuff that you want to put in the suitcase matters to how densely you can pack that suitcase. So if you have a bunch of baseballs or if you have a bunch of books, you can pack the books much more efficiently with less space left over in the suitcase than you can a bunch of baseballs. And in fact, spheres pack the least densely of all convex objects. And this is really actually important to a number of different industries. It's important to the candy makers who have to figure out how many M&Ms they can fit in a bag of candy, or to the people who make Toblerone to try to figure out how to shape their boxes so they can pack as many boxes together into a pallet. And it's also important to pharmaceutical manufacturers who have to figure out how different shaped tablets or different shaped pills, how many of them will fit into a bottle of a certain size and shape, or even how many granules of medicine will fill a single capsule. And it's even important to fruit growers, and this is a real photograph of cubic watermelon, I kid you not, watermelon that's been grown in a cubic box to give it this shape because cubes pack more efficiently than spheres do. So what in the world does all of this and watermelons have to do with nanotechnology? Well, it turns out that in the past 10 years, some of the most exciting advances in nanotechnology have been the community's ability to make particles of all sorts of different shapes. These particles can be made out of metals and ceramics and semiconductors and plastics, polymers, and they're very small particles. So they're particles that are smaller than a red blood cell, but slightly larger than, say, the width of a DNA double helix. So these are really microscopic or nanoscopic objects, and the ability to make them has become so exciting and so promising that now these kinds of nanoscopic objects could be the atoms and molecules of a next generation of materials if only we could figure out how to put these particles together, how to assemble them into some kind of organized structure for new materials and devices. So we're here in Michigan. I would be remiss to not show a picture from the original assembly line at Ford around 1920. And if we were to think about using the concepts of assembly lines, which revolutionized all of manufacturing in this country and the world, if we thought about applying those principles to nanotechnology, just consider that a 2-centimeter cube made of nanoparticles would have about 10 to the 20 nanoparticles in it. That's a 1 with 20 zeros after it. That's a lot of particles. And even if you were to place them a million at a time sequentially, and you place a million of them every second, it would take over 25,000 years to build up two centimeter cube of nanoparticles. So clearly we need different kinds of concepts than the traditional assembly line. And what we need is to exploit the forces that are naturally there between nanoparticles and entropy to get the particles to assemble themselves into an interesting and useful structure. And so over the past few years, my students and I have become very excited to study the role of shape in self-assembly and how that we can use that and entropy to make new kinds of structures and new materials. And so we've been studying polyhedral shapes. So polyhedra, the simplest polyhedra are the platonic solids, and there are five of them. And they're the simplest because each of them is made of only one kind of face, and the face or the facet is a simple polygon. And they're all the same, and there's only one kind of vertex. And of these simplest polyhedra, the very simplest platonic solid is the tetrahedron because it has four sides, and that's the minimum number of sides that you need to make a polyhedron. And what's interesting is that the question of how tetrahedra arrange, how they can pack, was actually discussed by Aristotle, and this is a quote translated by Guthrie from Aristotle around 330 BCE, and he thought that tetrahedra would be able to fill space perfectly like cubes with no space left over. But of course you can see that they don't, and all you need is to get your Dungeons and Dragons dice out of a drawer and stick them together with modeling putty that you can buy at the local hardware store. And if you put five of them together, then you see they fit together pretty well. Maybe there's a little gap in the middle. You put nine of them together, 20 of them together, makes an icosahedron. You could stick tetrahedra onto that, make a hexacontahedron. And the more tetrahedra that you stick to this, the more you see that there are these gaps. And the gaps get bigger, and there's more of them as you go out and out. And that is because tetrahedra cannot fill space. So you can never pack tetrahedra with a density or packing fraction of one. And this is a problem that started back with Aristotle in 330 BCE. Johannes Mueller, a.k.a. Regiomontanus, pointed out in the 1400s that Aristotle was actually wrong. Then a bunch of mathematicians got interested in it, and it's been studied a lot. This is a timeline that my student put together for me yesterday, and he's here, so I need to show it. But I love it. It's a little busy, but it's beautiful because because it shows you that you start back in ancient times, and then you go up through the millennia, and then through the centuries, and then to the years, the decades, the years, the months, and then we get to 27 December 2009, or as I finally refer to as how I spent my Christmas vacation in 2009, where we figured out what is the densest you could possibly pack tetrahedra, and just in case anyone ever stops you on the street and says, wait, what is the densest you could possibly pack tetrahedra? You can tell them that number is 85.63%, and it's a world record that is held by the University of Michigan. The New York Times thought that all of this flurry and excitement over how many tetrahedra you could fit in a box was so interesting The science writer Kenneth Chang wrote a Science Times article about it on January 4th, 2010. So for 1 week, it was the science story of the decade. So we were studying this problem, and one of the things we did was we took a bunch of tetrahedra and we threw them into a box and did the same kind of computer simulations that I showed you earlier. So there's a bunch of tetrahedra jiggling around, banging around, and it's hard to see, but they're actually ordering. And if you take a slice through the box and turn it on its side, you'd see this incredible kind of order in the system where these particles figure out how to organize themselves into all of these structures. And this thing on the right is a diffraction pattern. It's hard to see. It's what you'd get if you were to bounce x-rays off of this structure. And it's the kind of image that seriously makes a material scientist weep with joy, because they look at it and they say, oh, this is so complex. How could this system have figured out to do this without any kind of attractive forces? Just entropy, just because there are more ways for the particles to be ordered, more options than if the particles stayed disordered. And if we change the shape of the particles, we can get different kinds of structures. Always starting from some initial random thing and comparing it, you find that they always want to be in these crystal structures. So we can get, for example, diamond, which is a high-pressure form of carbon. And you can get high-pressure lithium, which is a structure that atomistically was only discovered a few years ago. And we can get other kinds of crystal structures, the metallic form of tin, tungsten, manganese, and even brass, just by changing the shape of the particles. And one of the most exciting ones, or one of my personal favorites, is this supercube, where particles come together into little, so six of these particles up here come together into a little cube, and the cubes assemble into bigger cubes, which assemble into bigger cubes. So it's a hierarchically assembled structure. Again, there are no instructions in the particles that say where to go. They just explore all the possible ways of organizing, and there are so many more ways for them to be ordered than disordered that this is what they form. And so because we have a lot of really fast computers here at the University of Michigan, we're able to study literally hundreds of different shapes and do tens of thousands of simulations. And what we've been able to do is connect now, for the first time, the shape of particles with the kinds of structures that they want to form, the kinds of crystals that they want to form. And so even without traditional forces based only on particle shape, we now have the blueprints to make materials classes whose properties mimic their atomic and molecular counterparts. And this is important and exciting because now we can begin to think about making new types of materials with new kinds of properties. So we can make shape-changing materials like the skin on this concept car that can change shape due to the changing aerodynamic conditions, or the canonical Uber shapeshifter from the Terminator, or even a transformer. We can also think about making smart materials like this Iron Man armor that could be strong as steel one second and lighter than air another, simply by changing environmental conditions. And we can also think about making new kinds of functional materials, like those that can bend light in interesting ways to make things look differently than they really are, like this cloaked Klingon bird of prey. And before you get me started, I can assure you I know that this is Romulan, actually, technology, and that the Klingons only acquired it from the Romulans. Only acquired it from the Romulans in 2267 in exchange for some D7 class battle cruisers. But maybe we will all learn one day that the Romulans actually acquired that technology by licensing it from the University of Michigan. Thank you for listening.